Live from Paradise Studios in New York, Strong Island Television presents Unger the Radar, starring Randy Unger.
Brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a two to match your attitude.
Tonight, Randy will be interviewing award-winning filmmaker Philip Eumanns of the new Tribeca Film Festival drama, Burning Cane. Randy will also be reviewing the new films, Long Shot and The Intruder, with special guest critics C.J. Oakland, Ryan Rizzuti, and Jason Weider. And now, here's your host, Randy Unger.
Hey guys, I'm Randy Unger. This is Unger the Radar. Welcome, where we talk all things film. And right now, we are right in the middle, well, at the tail end, rather, of the Tribeca Film Festival. And with me on the phone right now is 19-year-old filmmaker Philip Eumanns of the new award-winning drama, Burning Cane. Philip, how are you?
I'm good, man. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, this is very exciting. Best U.S. narrative feature, best cinematography, and best actor for Wendell Pierce. How does all this award attention, how is this affecting you? How do you feel right now?
It's awesome. I think the biggest thing about it for me is how validating it all kind of feels in terms of following my own voice, following my own creative instincts, you know, because I followed them all the way through making Burning Cane, from script to production to post-production. And so it just feels good that was good enough. You know what I mean? It feels good that following my creative instincts, it works. And it just builds confidence for me in terms of my artistic identity and the work that I do next. I know that trusting my creative voice is good enough.
And the film is so deep, so good. It deals with religion. It deals with loss, acceptance, bonding. How did the story come about?
Really, the biggest motivation for the story was my upbringing in the Southern Baptist Church. There were a lot of questions that I developed over time, over my childhood in the church. You know, a lot of questions about the doctrine that I had, a lot of the practices of the church, like, you know, how tithes are often waved around, while the people who can't donate tithes or donate to the church are left to kind of sit in their seats and just ruminate in the fact that they can't donate. It's just little hypotheses like that I picked up. But in that, it's nuanced, because so many of the people that have such a big effect on my life, or who have had such a big effect on my life, who've been so formative for me, I've met them through the church, you know. So it's not a rigid thing in that I can still humanize them, and I still sought to humanize them despite my ideological differences, you know.
Okay. And how old were you when you first thought this could be a movie?
Well, I was 16 when I wrote the first draft of the short, and then by the time I turned 17, my instructor at the New Orleans Center of Creative Arts named Isaac Webb told me that he thought that the film had feature potential and that expanding it to a feature could be possible. And then so from that, I became kind of obsessed with that idea. And then in the months leading into production during that summer, I was just churning out different drafts of the script, going through revisions, you know, having frequent table reads, just getting a lot of notes and feedback, because I knew that the revisions had to go quickly because we were moving into production so quickly. And it just seemed like a financially feasible thing to do, one, because the story was already so grounded in character. You know, it doesn't really involve any sort of, you know, special effects or any real, you know, high budget levels of execution or anything.
Right.
Really, it's so much about the community, so much about these people. And Laurel Valley, where we shot, is such a character on its own right, you know. Our production designer, Ojo, me and him would talk about how there's so much of a set here already built, but so much of the work was really even just taking stuff away or moving things around in terms of actually building the setting, because the setting was really there. So it seemed like this was the time to do it if ever it was going to happen.
Wow. Now, you directed, you wrote it, you edited, and you also did the cinematography. What was it like wearing so many hats?
It was the best summer of my life. I think since it was out of necessity, it wasn't my initial decision to shoot it as well. Initially, I was going to work with a cinematographer named Jacob Johnson, who's out of Alabama. He's a good friend of mine. I met him when I was working as a first AC on a UCLA thesis film. I think that was maybe a year prior to shooting Burning Kane. And we'd always wanted to work together, and it seemed like that was going to be, you know, how it all moved forward, except it became clear since he had a wife and a recent baby that he needed pen work, and we were teenagers who were working on, you know, definitely a low budget, and we couldn't really afford to pay him what we wanted to or what that work really would have called for. And so because of that, he had to go find paying work, and I was going to shoot it. Now, hindsight, I guess it was a little bit of a blessing in disguise, as they say, because now watching the film, I really couldn't imagine it in anybody else's eyes but my own. But it was not my initial intention to it. And I had so much help, you know, my production designer, producer Ojo, producer Mose Mayer, everybody just really made sure that the set was held down while I had to juggle those hats, you know.
And now, speaking of having help, I know that Ben Zeitlin was involved with the production.
Yes. Yeah, well, Ben was... So the thing about Ben is that I met Ben... So we had enough resources to get us through production, but I met Ben actually immediately after principal photography ended because I sent him a short trailer that I had cut up and sent that to him and said I wanted to meet with him, and then we became friends. He responded to me over Instagram, and we became friends. And then after that, he helped me get a grant that gave me a cash award for finishing funds, an editing studio at Second Line Stages, and then Final Color with PhotoCam. Okay. And then on top of that, he helped facilitate all of our feedback sessions, and he would spend hours upon hours and days with me just combing through the edit, offering a lot of creative mentorship. So yeah, Ben's involvement was integral to getting Burning Kane into the position that it is today.
And for those who don't know who Ben Zeitlin is, brilliant filmmaker. He did Beasts of the Southern Wild a few years back, and it's just a very gritty, human, realistic drama. And I think you can see some of that style here as well in Burning Kane. So, yeah, great collaboration.
Ben's a great filmmaker, too. I mean, I'm so excited for his next project, man. But, he's and it's not even a conscious influence. I just think that me and Ben have a similar sort of style in terms of like searching for the human elements and everything, you know?
Okay.
And I think that meshed in a way, but yeah, I mean, working with Ben is incredible.
Nice. And now speaking of collaborations, you've got Wendell Pierce, great actor. He just won an award for this film. What was it like working with him and the rest of his great cast?
Well, working with Wendell was awesome because, first thing, Wendell is, like you said, he's a great actor. He's just such a student of the craft. I mean, when I on the first day of shooting in the church, I went into his dressing room and I saw his script, and it was so annotated. Like there were questions leading off of almost every line, and there was just so much active conversation on the page, and that was really humbling for me to see this actor that I looked up to, that's such a prominent figure in my community, respect my material that much. So that was first off, I was like, all right, this is awesome. And then working with him, I learned so much about directing, how it's so much less, you know, over the shoulder, so much less about me saying, okay, this is a mark here, or, you know, it's so much more about the conversation, about character motivation. And so much of that was done beforehand. And now this is where the casting is so key, because once we got on set, since I did have to juggle a ton of hats, I did rely on the fact that our conversation, so much of our conversations done in pre-production, would carry what was about to happen here.
Okay.
You know, and it did, luckily, because this man made some incredible choices with the character. And, he's a brilliant actor. And I think what was big about that is I learned also, when you're working with a talent like that, like you have to respect that you're not supposed to be over their shoulder. You have to give them room and the space to create and breathe on their own as artists. And yeah, I definitely learned that with working with Wendell. Thanks.
Nice. Now, I'm curious, what were some challenges you faced during production? Philip?
Hey, I'm here.
Okay, good.
No, hey, one second.
Sure.
What's up?
live TV.
Hey, I'm back.
Oh, sorry about there you
that. Go. Something with the theater manager at the
okay.
At the location.
So just two more questions, okay?
For sure.
So I'm just curious, what were some challenges you guys faced during production?
Oh, okay. That's an interesting question. All right. So a major challenge that we had was actually dealing with the overseer at the plantation that we were shooting at in Laurel Valley.
Okay.
They were not very happy about us being there.
Huh.
You know, I do have to recognize that going in there, there was some fears for sure, given the fact that we were a predominantly black casting crew.
Okay.
And we have to, I think it's known that there are, you know, a lot of racial hostilities, you know, still present in rural southern Louisiana. And so I think we did meet that pretty head on in terms of dealing with the overseer at Laurel Valley Plantation, because he called the cops on us a few times, and luckily it didn't turn south, but there were some points in time that were definitely frightening. There was one time when Wendell had to, you know how if you're driving a car down a road
mm-hmm.
and you need to turn around, so you'll pull into someone's driveway just to turn around and go the other way?
Right.
So Wendell was driving down the cane field. It's a scene when you see him when he's driving drunk down the cane field, and he had to pull in aside into like this like ditch sort of area that I think was just on the property, literally right on the property.
Okay.
And then he pulls right out immediately. And he called the cops on us because he said that we were trespassing.
Oh, my God.
and within minutes, our entire set was just swarmed by five or six LaFouche Parish sheriff's officers. And luckily, I had enough people on set to help to defuse the situation.
Okay.
But it just became very clear that this guy was not really happy with us being there at all.
I'd call that a challenge.
Yeah.
Wow, that's intense. Okay. Well, last question. Obviously, you're very young. You're 19. I'm just curious, who are some of your filmmaker influences?
Ooh. So I love PTA, Paul Thomas Anderson.
Nice.
Steve McQueen, Barry Jenkins, Malick, of course.
Mm.
And I'm biased to say, but I do want to say Ben, because I have looked up his work for a long time. Gloria C and Beast are honestly some of my favorite picks.
Mm.
But yeah, those are probably my most formative, the most formative influences for me in terms of filmmaking.
Nice, awesome. So what's next? Can you talk about anything that you're working on now, or do we have to just wait and see?
Yeah, so my next project is about the New Orleans chapter of the Black Panthers in 1970.
Okay.
I've been interviewing them since I was a sophomore in high school, and so I got to know them really well, got to know them as people, got to know them for their heroic acts in the community. But what I learned over time is that as I got to know them more as people, you know, their fallible moments became clear to me, but it took some maturing for me to sort of recognize and not be alienated by it and just kind of and kind of deem that their heroism and all the things that they did for their community is in no way discredited by their moments of showing that they're people, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And there's an interest to that. To me, there's so much interest for me in just showcasing the duality of people, the nuance of people, how people aren't discredited by their fallible moments. In fact, it makes their heroism so much more approachable.
Okay.
Whenever you think about the fact that they're still human beings at the end of the day, you know, and with the Panthers also, a great example of that is like Malik Rahim, one of my good friends from the New Orleans chapter. He was a part of them helping feed 100 kids every morning in the free breakfast program. But Malik also had some times where he admits that he wasn't as present in his kid's life as he was.
Philip, still there? Philip, you there, Phil? I think we lost him again. But, okay then. Well, it's a great film, guys. Burning Cain. It's a very interesting tale of religion, loss, and acceptance. And Philip is a very young filmmaker, and I really wish we were still speaking with him. But he's a great filmmaker, and I look forward to seeing a lot more of his stuff. All right, guys. Well, we're going to take a short commercial break, and we'll be back with our film review segment right after this commercial break.
Under the Radar is brought to you by Magnitude Jewelry. Add a 2 to match your attitude. Patent pending, interchange genuine gemstone and crystal EMF protection jewelry. For more information, please visit magnitudejewelry.com/gemgirl or call 718-268-6634.
Hey guys, we're back. Under the Radar. I'm your host, Randy Unger. And that was unfortunate because that was a very good interview with a very talented young filmmaker. And yeah, again, I wish him the best of luck and all that. Now, guys, hey.
Hey.
CJ Oakland. Jason Wider. How's it going, guys? CJ is no stranger to the couch.
No, I've been here a lot.
More than you can bear to remember.
Yep.
And Jason is your first time.
First time here, very excited.
Yeah, this is cool. Yeah. So, have you guys been at the Tribeca Film Festival at all? Or
no, I don't have the money for that.
No, okay. Jason, any interest?
I'd love to. I have been to Cannes once.
Oh, cool! Really?
Yeah, okay. I was working with a production company, and it was amazing.
Nice. And you're also an actor. I know that.
Yes.
And we actually interviewed Joseph Amendola and Jennifer Covey. Yeah. All these great talent from the film. I'm actually surprised you weren't there, but.
I wasn't invited.
Oh, no. Well, you're here now. So
there's only so much room on the couch.
That's true. No, we had stools in the back of the couch. It was a little crowded, but it would have been cool to see you there as well.
Yeah, next time.
Yeah. And CJ, I know you've been involved with Joe as well.
Yeah, I've helped him out like a few stuff like behind the scenes. Yeah. I think it was like an extra in one thing he did. Mm. I can't remember what movie it was, but it wasn't Broken Hearted.
Okay.
He kept messaging me on Facebook saying like he needed people to help out with the crew, and I'd be like, every time I had something come up, so I could just never do it, so I wasn't involved.
Okay, that's cool. So, all right, guys, let's dive right in. We've got two films to talk about, two very different films. It's usually the case.
Yeah.
We'll start with the. I'm debating now. I guess we could start with the better of the two. No, let's do the weaker of the two. I'd say, The Intruder, starring Dennis Quaid, Megan Good, and Michael Ealy. Basically tells, oh, there's a lovely picture.
There's
Dennis Quaid being all kinds of crazy. So basically, it's about a young married couple. They move into Martha's Vineyard. It's like a dreamlike situation. It's a beautiful house. And the house that they buy it from is a psychotic, though at first very kind and neighborly, Dennis Quaid, who eventually becomes this psychotic, obsessive individual.
How you doing?
And, yeah, things get a little out of hand. So, yeah, CJ, what did you think of this?
I enjoyed it. It's nothing really special. Like, we've kind of seen movies like this before, but it's a fun little psychological thriller.
Mm-hmm.
The biggest thing I had is, like, the theater I went into, like, a lot of people were, like, making jokes to each other, and it's, like, a lot of moments where, like, there was a lot of bursts out laughing or people, like, reacting to the movie, and that's the most fun you can have with something like
this. Yeah, people shouting at the screen.
Yeah, like, one where you're, like, every time Dennis Quaid shows up doing something else, like, show him over the lawn, you just hear half the audience go, like, oh, again.
I know, one of those.
Yeah.
Oh, and we've got another guest critic here.
Oh. I think we got an intruder of our own.
Oh. Yeah, I'm the intruder of the episode.
Nicely done, Mr. Ryan.
This planned-themed intruder episode.
perfect. So, yeah, yelling at the screen, for sure. This
is
that,
like,
type of movie.
I feel like it's a movie, if you just, like, watch on your own, it's nothing too special. But you can, like, put it on with a group of friends,
yeah. And
you'll have a fun time watching it. It's enjoyable.
It is enjoyable. Jason, what do you think?
I mean, top off what you said, like, the word I used was forgettable. Yeah, it was very forgettable. I think there were some really good, I mean, there were a few things I appreciated.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I appreciated how good when Dennis Quaid was coming on to her, like, mm-hmm. She like faked into it and tried to trick him rather than all the horror mover tropes of just like, oh, get away from me. Oh, yeah. I don't. Yeah.
She tried to disarm him with like, yeah,
I thought her,
playing into it.
I thought her acting was very good in it. I thought, at first I didn't think, I thought Dennis Quaid's lack of subtlety was not good, but then I realized he's not supposed to be subtle.
Yeah.
And then I realized, oh, so he is playing his part well.
Yeah. From an actor's perspective, yeah. You appreciated that.
Yeah. Okay. Ely, I didn't like. It seemed like he just kept jumping around in every scene, different motivations, different, and without like a build.
Yeah. And the whole thing with him, like, you know, like flirting and kind of cheating, but not really.
Yeah. And then like flirting and all this and not calling her. Then all of a sudden, wait, I'm not like she. He was like, mm-hmm. What are you doing?
Yeah.
It just didn't make. There was not a lot to his.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of. I mean, I really haven't seen much of Ely's work, but he seems like a
one-note.
Yeah,
I don't think that's
actor.
On him. I don't think that's so much like his fault as much as like just performance. Like, it really reminded me of that movie Obsessed with Idris Elba and Ali Larter and Beyonce, where Beyonce's whole character is the one who's not being flirted with is angry wife. And that's it. She plays the same tone in every single scene, which is to Beyonce's role, but that's also just how the role is written.
Yeah.
Whereas this one, it really feels like it's focused on Megan Good's character and Dennis Quaid. And Michael Ealy's just kind of there to be like, I don't like this guy. But so it's like, I'm in the right, but I need a reason for you not to like me.
And
so
also,
we can drag the movie out.
One-dimensional characters.
Yeah, which I really thought this movie was like, okay, it reminds me of Obsessed, kind of mixed with Lakeview Terrace.
Right.
And I found out David Lowery, the writer of this movie, wrote both of those as well.
And Screen Gems released both films. This and Lakeview
Terrace. So it really felt like, okay, that's why it seems like a nice little mix of all these
together. It's a formula that works. Ryan, what did you think of The Intruder?
So I think out of the four of us, I definitely liked it the least out of the four of us. I thought it was definitely probably one of the worst movies I'll see this year.
Mm.
If in a bottom 10 list, I don't know where it'll gauge, but I think somewhere on the bottom 10 it'll be there.
Well, that brings me to another question. Out of last year, what was your least favorite movie?
My least favorite movie of last year, I had a couple. I have some written down. I actually have it on my phone. I can pull it up right now to tell you that. But I think with The Intruder, I think what we're really missing is we forgot about that whole you text me instead of calling me subplot. That's the crux of the entire movie.
That's funny.
It's the crux of
the
whole
film. It's ridiculous,
though.
Like, he was in a bar. He couldn't hear. He had, you know, it's quick and easy texting.
Yeah, it sounds like a thing. Like, I can understand it being for a scene, like, I can understand if that's something like set up why it's there, but it never really comes into play again.
Right,
so I don't know why it's made into a thing.
Right. And it wasn't funny either. It was just kind of sad and pointless.
But again, like, you're not watching this movie for their relationship. You're watching it for Dennis Quaid.
I want to see him go full crazy. And we get a lot of scenes where he does just that. And I don't think I can name another Dennis Quaid movie where he's been this villainous.
I didn't think of
one either.
He's had times where he's been crazy, but not on this, not the Randy Quaid level.
This one, he's just like, I'm going to have fun with this, and he did.
Yeah, he did.
There's a couple moments where it's like, when it gets into it in the third act, where like he's trying to be a horror person, like it goes a little too over the top. I honestly really liked it when he's playing it, where he just shows up with like a big smile, and it's immediately like, this person might try to wear my face, and you're like, not sure.
No, there's a
like,
scene
he plays that really well.
There's a scene where he's in his bedroom or in the hotel room or whatever, and he's just like trying to smile.
Like, he's just practicing a smile, so he looks
it's
friendly
so
and not threatening, and I'm that's really well done. Like,
but at the beginning of the movie, he really seems like a decent, like, average Joe. And
see, I thought the second he appeared on screen, I'm like, this guy seems mentally unhinged.
Did you really? Well,
I would not have thought that.
Maybe a little phony. Maybe a little fake.
A little fake.
But he seems like a genuine kind of, I mean, relatively genuine guy.
My biggest issue with the movie is I felt like it was two separate movies. I felt like Dennis Quaid was in his own movie, and then everyone else was making a completely different movie. And I liked the Dennis Quaid movie.
Yeah.
And I didn't like the everything else that was going on.
Yeah. He was the strongest element of this movie. And it's a shame because, I don't know, The Intruder.
So
definitely felt like an early 90s thriller, you know?
A little bit. I've seen a lot of movies like it, but it's like this one, it's enjoyable enough. It's never trying to be anything special. It's just the fact that it has Dennis Quaid. Like, if it was anyone else playing the part, it could be a lot worse.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But, so it's like, it's not one of the worst movies I think I'll see this year, which stay on Randy's show. He'll show you some worse movies. Like, as soon as you said, what are some worse movies of this year? I'm like, I can list a couple.
I learned my lesson with Welcome to Acapulco. That was just...
I'm never going to let that go.
No,
that
was,
it was truly,
it's
like,
atrocious.
I will watch The Intruder for the rest of my life if I never have to watch that movie again.
I actually have a question for you guys about the movie. Is what do you think they were trying to say something about race relations? Because
I didn't really get that.
It seems like there was almost trying to have a subtext of it, and every review that I've read so far tries to pinpoint some sort of thing about it, and I was like forcing ideas because I just read that the reviews had all these ideas.
On the surface,
and
you would think that,
but it could just be the casting, which is the hope.
I didn't get a racial element. Yeah. I mean,
I never saw that. Like, I got more like, if anything, rural guy versus like country people. Like, that's the biggest dichotomy I got.
Like, an issue.
But they're not anything race related. Yeah, like, just when he starts showing a little bit of interest in the wife, it's more who she is. It's not like he's reacting to them. Yeah. Like, if you look at, like, Lakeview Terrace, that's about, like, Samuel L. Jackson kind of being
hammers
racist.
The racism.
Yeah, like, that's the same guy writing this one, so that's all I'm like, if they wanted to make it a racist angle, it would be a lot more obvious. It would not be that subtle that we don't notice it.
There's only one area in the movie that I can think of that has the race element, because I was exactly the same way. I didn't see, it felt so not racist, because you think that, even in the trailer, you think, oh, Dennis Quaid's going to be a racist, he's going to hate that this family's taking over his house, and you don't get that at all. No. He's just mentally unhinged. But the only thing I could see a race thing being the guns, being the whole, that one really weird expositionary line of dialogue
with the,
where he's
drive-by,
like,
or whatever.
About, Michael Ealy's brother died in a drive-by, so he hates guns, he doesn't want him on his property, and then that kind of comes back in
the
last
really
scene.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the only thing I can see that could be a race thing.
Yeah. But yeah, that's
violence.
More, again, like, I think
gun
just
violence,
like, people who live in, like, an urban area like the city versus the rural area where you just have guns everywhere.
I agree. Yeah.
So I think that it doesn't really seem like a race thing.
It tries to tap into these, like, serious themes, but it kind of falls flat in that respect, and just goes for the straight up thriller route.
It's best when it's just trying to be campy, where it's just like Dennis Quaid is mowing their lawn and trying to act like super nice about
it.
It
kind of builds the tension, like, why is he still here?
Yeah.
Why is he having wine with my wife? You know?
fake chasing teenagers with an axe.
The only thing I really hate about this movie is that it does what a lot of horror movies are doing, so I can't fault it on its own. But every time, like, Dennis Quaid pops up surprisingly, giant loud horror sting every single time.
On the score, you mean?
Yeah, like, there's one moment where, like, they do it where, like, lights go by and you see Dennis Quaid in the background, and it's so nicely done, and I'm like, I just want that for the rest of the movie. Like, I want them to be, like, talking and just in the background unannounced. You can just, like, see Dennis Quaid looking. That would have made my life.
Jason,
then just every time there's just a every time you know he's
very Michael Myers.
I just wish that was actually a little more downplayed, because
there was
a good have you seen I'm forgetting, there was a great horror movie that came out.
Okay. I'm bad with names too.
Name a couple things.
Sorry.
We can do this.
The headless girl driving by with the allergy attack.
Hereditary.
And how they had a lot of times where, or at the end, where she just walks by on the wall, like, very slightly, very noticeable.
In the background.
Very background, as well as the Netflix show, The Haunting of Hill House. Yeah, there were so many ghosts.
I've heard
in the back, there were so many different little shots with ghosts in it. Yeah, so I really liked that it was a little more subtle.
But the flashes of Dennis Quaid in the shadows.
That was too much, because I couldn't tell, like, what was happening there. That was just bad editing.
Right.
I think it was more, if they played that way more subtle and just, like, made it where he's very campy and obvious, like, talking to them up front, and then very subtle where you almost don't notice him in the background, that would have worked much better,
right,
I think.
Right.
But it's still, like, it plays well enough on its own.
I'd say my biggest issue when it came to, like, the subtlety of the horror was they couldn't pick. They didn't want to pick. They wanted to do both. Like, they did Megan Good's walking in the kitchen, and Dennis, you see Dennis Quaid in the background kind of blurry with a weird smile on his face. And I was like, oh, that was good. That was a clever, like, horror. And then they turn, and he's not there anymore. And then immediately he pops in and gives you a jump scare. And I'm like, if you just ended the scene there, that would have done so much more horror-wise than having him jump in and do the eh with
these
the
jump
noise.
Scares, man. I really can't stand them.
It
it's
really
so
has become the trend.
So it's cheap.
They can be done, like, well. Like, I thought Pet Sematary had a couple of good jump scares. The new one. I thought it had a couple of good jump scares. I thought, like, Us did a good job when it came to jump scares. You can use jump scares in a way that conveys horror in a very good way.
Right.
But you don't see it. And I think seeing something further away is even more scary, like in Get Out, when you see the Gardner running past.
That's still
Daniel
one of my favorite shots. Like, that's so good.
Because you see it coming, and it's just so, it gets scary.
And back to Us, there's a shot where you could see, you know, the white family being terrorized.
Yes.
But it's from a distance.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like no sound. That is true horror.
Yeah, Jordan Peele really understands how to build tension without needing to do like a jump scare for like that quick release of just like, okay, we made the audience jump. They're scared.
It's
now.
Like it's a combination of like physical horror and psychological. It just meshes so well with his movies.
Yeah, camera placement has a lot to do with it in horror movies. Like I even had in The Intruder, there was parts where I thought the camera would go certain places to convey more horror, and it didn't. Like when they're in the house, the first time Dennis Quaid sees the house after they redo it for Thanksgiving dinner, and he's like, what happened to the tapestry? And Michael Ealy's just going on this long thing about this painting, and you're just like, the music's getting louder, and you're just seeing Dennis Quaid get angrier and angrier as he's talking.
Yeah.
It like focused more in on Dennis Quaid and like pushed in on his face as it was going, it would have been creepier and more unsettling. And then it just came off like they decided to do that in the edit. Instead of while they were shooting. So maybe it was bad direction.
I'd say yes.
Although I did like a little bit like the point of oration where we kind of had it more from Dennis Quaid as the main character, where a lot of it is like how he's seeing it and how he's looking. But it seems like they chose to do that on and off. Like they weren't very consistent with it.
Right.
Which I would have preferred.
It wasn't really his perspective. It was just our perspective of him.
Yeah, like there are a few really nice moments done.
Yeah.
But it's not consistent enough where I don't think it was like a style they had in mind. I think they just saw good moments or stuff just happened to come together.
And I think...
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
No, I was going to say, and I think we're focusing on all these small little like more nuanced things because once again there's nothing big, there's nothing rememberable,
there's nothing
huge, there's nothing like there's no one
Dennis
scene
Quaid's
we're all like, oh my god, it's just exactly.
Are you a horror fan, Jason?
I do like horror movies. I'm not up to date on many of the new ones
you
that come
see
out.
I
really enjoyed
it. I've been
that's
really into it.
Yeah. I would not pay $17 for this movie.
No.
But I did. I think we all did. So
this one, I would say, like, wait until it comes out on like DVD or Netflix and watch it because it's a fun time. I don't think it's worth a full movie ticket price.
It's
I'm
a
not
strong
sure.
B movie, I'd call it.
Yeah, this one is definitely like if you have this and another fun movie and you're all just hanging out and put something on and have a few drinks, it can be a fun time.
And speaking of fun movies, I think that leads into our next movie, much better than The Intruder. We've got Long Shot. It's a romantic comedy starring Seth Rogen and Charlize Theron. Basically, Theron plays a politician who is very successful, very beautiful, obviously. And Seth Rogen plays this kind of pot-smoking he's a free-spirited journalist who was actually babysat by Charlize Theron when they were like teenagers. And now they're joined back together. And she hires him as a speechwriter, and sparks fly. And this is a really surprisingly charming romantic comedy. And Ryan, what do you think?
Honestly, I thought this was probably Seth Rogen's best movie since This Is the End. So in 6 years, I would say this is definitely his best movie. And I think a lot of it has to do with it was directed by Jonathan Levine, who directed him in 50-50, where he was a supporting character.
That was awesome.
Yeah, that
and
was a good movie.
The Night Before.
That was
which
decent.
Which was kind of an ensemble comedy.
Right.
Which I thought was probably the best Christmas movie to come out in the past like 10 years. There's not many good
That's
Christmas
a bold
movies.
Statement. Okay.
There's not that many good Christmas movies, and I thought it was a good parody of Christmas.
And it had that flavor of Superbad with Evan Goldberg, Seth Rogen. I think they wrote it. So.
Yeah, and I think that Jonathan Levine, I think as a comedy director, knows how to get the best out of Seth Rogen.
Mm-hmm. He knows. He gets him.
He gets him. Yeah, yeah. He gets his comedy. He gets why we think he's funny. And I think he played it up really well, and I like that it was a political comedy that didn't take a side. It was a political comedy that was like, we're a political comedy. We're going to make fun of everyone politically.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to make jokes aimed at Republicans. We're going to make jokes aimed at Democrats. We're going to have jokes aimed at both.
But it didn't jam that agenda down your throat.
No,
it wasn't like a political
It wasn't
movie.
Like Man of the Year.
It wasn't so much about these politics or making jokes about it. It's just politics in general. Just like the machine of what it is and like
except for the
idea of compromise. Yeah.
Except, what?
Except for the environment.
It's like, why would you take a stance against the environment? That's the safest thing you can do.
Yeah, that's
very
like,
true.
I'm
no,
watching
very
this
true.
Movie and I think fuck trees in the beast. So I don't agree with the political sentiment here.
Oh.
I want the earth to die. I'm just a Captain Planet villain.
I'm just a Captain Planet villain.
But the chemistry between Rogen and Theron was insanely good. Like, I'm surprised they haven't made a movie before this. So, Jason, what did you think of their acting, their chemistry? Coming off of a romantic movie yourself.
Yeah. There were parts of it that I really loved, and there are parts of it that really bugged me.
Okay.
Basically, the entire beginning up until the party scene bugged me because...
Would they hit the molly?
No. When they meet for the first time, because there was actual chemistry. There was really good, and each character on its own, though. It's a somewhat serious film. Yeah. It's in a tone. There's a serious tone surrounding it with all the politics and everything it's trying to say, except it just has a ridiculous amount of silly at certain times.
Yeah.
Ridiculous silly that just doesn't fit in the same tone when you're trying to be a little more serious.
Right.
And I thought that was really, and Seth Rogen's voice seemed to be very
He's always that way.
No, but in the beginning it was like extra annoying.
Okay.
I don't know. And I'm nitpicking, I'm sorry, but like it really, I don't know, something about the first part of the movie really got me, and then it settled in, and then I saw their chemistry, and then all of that.
So you didn't think the blend of comedy and like drama, and there were some elements of thriller too.
The comedy was good, it's just some of the ridiculousness that they had. When they had the first scene with the Nazi saluting.
Right.
I was not, he was being very obvious. Like, he's trying to be this very, very very serious journalist.
Right.
And he was not really then trying to blend in with the people around him.
Right.
But he then gets the tattoo, tries to get the tattoo just to blend around. Like, it's just not consistent.
It was contradictory.
Yeah.
I see that more as part of his character than an issue with the movie. Mm-hmm. I think that is his character supposed to be like that. Like, even later in the movie, they kind of show how he's just, like, really crazy, has one thing on his mind, will, like, stick with that. He doesn't compromise at all. He does, like, that's part of his character. And I thought the opening scene kind of did a really good job of, like, showing exactly... It did a good job of showing the tone of the movie, I thought.
Okay.
Because it showed you exactly how absurd... It was realistic, but absurd.
Right.
We're going to do things that aren't going to be in this world.
Right.
We're creating a world. And I thought him jumping out of a window, hitting a car, and smacking against the concrete, and getting right up. Yeah. I thought that right there. I was like, oh, so that's the tone of the movie.
Right.
That's what we're going for.
It's kind of like intelligent humor peppered with like really
absurd,
idiotic.
I do get what you're saying. Like a couple times, it does jump to like absurd, ridiculous moments, which don't quite fit overall.
Yeah.
But it does happen sometimes. But I did like... Just because I sat down in the movie like right as it was playing, and it starts off with a scene about like a Nazi meeting in an apartment, and I'm like, am I in the right movie? And then it cuts around to Seth Rogen looking super uncomfortable, and I'm like, okay, I get what they're going for now.
Well, it's funny you mentioned, am I in the right movie? Because I when I walked into The Intruder, it was like the scene of like a like the city and you know, the roads, and it didn't seem like
I didn't think I was in the right movie.
Right. It's like, oh, The Intruder. Okay, is there another Intruder? I mean,
I'll be honest, I showed up to the movie late. I got there later on, so I wasn't sure. Sure. I missed like the very beginning.
Yeah, where they're like in San Francisco. It was odd.
I got there when they were showing the house.
Oh, really?
Too.
Okay.
Yeah.
With The Intruder, I thought I was in the wrong movie because everyone else in the theater was over 60 years old. So I was like, oh, this is a real pro-Quaid crowd.
Yeah.
This is a real pro-Quaid crowd. So that's what threw me off. And then when the opening started, I'm like, I think everyone thinks we're in the wrong theater right now.
Yeah.
But back to Long Shot.
Back to Long Shot.
I really enjoyed it. I thought they did a really good job of the mix of humor. I thought, take Bob Odenkirk's character, who's a celebrity president, but he's not making fun of Trump. It's not a parody of Trump. It's just making fun of how absurd it is for an actor to become president or a celebrity.
I really like how they played his character.
More Reagan joke.
Yeah. Right.
Like, if anything, like, if you're trying to say, like, they did that as a parody of Trump, no. Trump is, like, beyond that. Like,
yes.
Yeah. No person who's a filmmaker or a writer could ever create a character like Trump being our president.
Yeah.
Just because it's a situation out there.
Like, out there.
Anything in modern day politics, like, you could not do it in a show. Like, if West Wing tried to do it, like, a reality star becomes president, is in a war of words with North Korea over Twitter. It's like, no one would buy that, like, as a season. It's like, come on, that's too much.
They'd have to bring the actor who played Biff Tannen to play Trump in the West Wing. That'd be a strange episode.
That'd be great. Oh, my God. I want them to bring back West Wing for that now.
Yeah, right. Yeah. We'll reach out to Aaron Sorkin.
Reach out to Netflix. They'll greenlight anything.
That's true.
Oh, God. So back to Long Shot. So you're not, are you, is it safe to
say? I'm a fan. I am a fan.
But are you a fan of Seth Rogen?
Yeah, I loved This Is the End. I loved his part in Superbad. Yeah, I loved Pineapple Express.
One of the great modern day comedies, Superbad.
Love Superbad.
Superbad really did do like a tonal shift. Like that and Hangover coming out at the same time. Yeah. But I really love Superbad. I saw that when I was like 18 in theaters. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, this is a really good film and it's so different from everything else.
Because you got from the late 90s to the early 2000s, you had like American Pie and all those like raunchy teen comedies. Yeah. This was a raunchy adult.
But it never went like all the way there. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're coming from the creators of Superbad. They're coming out with
Good
now
Boys, another right?
movie. Good Boys. I saw that.
Looking forward to that. That should be good.
Yeah, you have that and,
and you're even
the,
younger.
The
Booksmart.
That one looks so much better.
That's directed by
though.
Olivia Wilde.
Yeah,
yeah, and produced by Will Ferrell.
Will Ferrell and
Adam. That one looks really good.
Yeah.
So I'm interested in both of those because they're similar but different because they like have the same type of movie but they're two completely different versions of that type.
It's the same theme.
It's the same theme, but
actors.
Booksmart is nerdy girls.
A little older.
Yeah, nerdy girls in high school that are graduating that realized we could have partied and still made it to
That's
college.
That's Superbad, pretty much.
Yeah, it's very similar because the whole thing about Dartmouth and State and Superbad.
But with Good Boys, they're like 11 years old. So
yeah,
it's gonna
they're,
be very
they're 11 years old, so they really pepper that in.
I really wonder what their parents thought during production.
Well, apparently the parents were like very cool with it. Yeah. Like I read like an article about like Jacob. Well, I guess Jacob Tremblay went from like Room to the Predator to now being the lead in Good Boys. So I guess
the kid in the Room kid is in this.
Yeah, he's the kid in Room,
wasn't
and
he
he's the kid in the Predator
movie.
Last
year?
It's like Secret Shut-In? I think Shut-In might have been the name. I think it was like a Naomi Watts horror movie.
Like a haunted house.
One of those seven Naomi Watts horror movies that come out every year.
Yeah. Wow. All right, guys. So we've got some time. What are we looking forward to that's coming out in theaters soon? I know, we'll save you to the end. I know I always catch you off guard with that question.
No, I was just going to say, like, I was going to say Godzilla. Like, I'm the biggest Godzilla fan, and every time I see the trailer play, I am so happy. Like, the last Godzilla movie was okay. Like, I didn't, like, they changed Godzilla's design, but I didn't mind. Like, it looks good on screen, but we never saw him. Like, in the whole movie, every time it's like, okay, Godzilla's finally going to show up with a giant monster, and they're going to fight.
Yeah.
And then it cuts to, like, two people sitting in a living room, and on TV we see the action happening. And even the third act, they keep cutting away from it. I'm like, I just want to see Godzilla fight a monster. Is that so hard?
You're talking about the first one with Bryan Cranston, right?
Yeah, the Bryan Cranston one.
Now I heard mixed reviews on that.
Yeah,
I didn't see it though.
It wasn't bad, but it's
20
like
minutes are good.
It's a movie about boring characters because Bryan Cranston isn't in it the whole time, unfortunately. And it keeps cutting to just like other characters doing stuff, and then it's like Godzilla's in it for less than 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Like, and you just see him on screen and like these small
bursts. That
kind of
sounds like Cloverfield.
Yeah, like it's honestly
they
almost
barely
like Cloverfield.
Showed the
like it's a little more than Cloverfield, but not as much. And it pissed me off so much because it's like that's all I want to see.
Is it better than Cloverfield in your opinion?
Yes, because I like Godzilla more as a monster, and also I really didn't like the blurry cam.
I love
like,
Cloverfield.
I enjoyed it, but it's just sometimes when I watch it, it's like I got to take a break. It's a bit too much.
Okay.
But this movie has so many monsters in it, and it looks so good.
It's going to be epic. Yeah.
Like you have Rodan, Mothra, King Ghidorah, and I'm like, from how they did this movie, I don't know how I'd feel about it. And every time I see this trailer, it just gives me more and more hope for it. Like, this looks so amazing. It's the movie I've always wanted to see.
And right now,
I can't wait.
Hollywood's goal is just, how can we top each movie? We've had Endgame, which was pretty insane. Mm-hmm. But the new Godzilla looks like it's trying to top that as well. So we'll see what happens.
Yeah. Well, when I saw Endgame, they showed like a very long trailer for Godzilla.
Yeah, like a 5-minute trailer.
The entire theater like stood up and applause at the end of the trailer. So I'm hoping that we're not the only people excited for Godzilla. Because I'm super excited for Godzilla. I'm like, can this be the one that like Godzilla becomes just as popular as the Avengers? Like,
oh, that's what I'm hoping. Like, I really want this to kick it off because like Godzilla was okay, King Kong was pretty good, but it's like none of them really got big. This one, just watching the trailer, just seeing like the sheer amount of action and how competently done that action is. Like, it looks so good.
It looks so well made, and it's amazing because it's from the director of Krampus. Yeah. So he went from Krampus to Godzilla 2?
I loved Krampus. Like, Krampus was well
was
done.
Was that worth seeing? Like, it looks so strange, like such a strange blend of horror comedy.
It is.
Does it, but does it work? Is what
it does.
Saying.
If okay. you want to watch a horror movie on Christmas, that's the one to watch. Yeah.
Okay. Krampus is good because it's done like a comedy angle. It doesn't take itself too seriously, but the monster designs are really well done.
Very
Everything
well done.
Is creative. It's not the same thing overall.
Okay.
The characters are interesting enough. It's a fun movie. I recommend Krampus.
Cool.
From however many years ago.
Jason.
That's the same guy who did Trick or Treat, right?
Okay.
I think he is. Yeah, I think he is.
He did Trick or Treat, Krampus, and now he's doing
Godzilla King of Monsters.
Yeah, like that's all I need. That's the three movies, and I'm like, okay, I like this director.
I've never actually seen a Godzilla movie.
Not even Matthew Broderick?
No, I've not seen a single. But
okay,
as soon as the trailer started, and I didn't even know it was going to be Godzilla, I thought this is going to be a great movie.
Nice.
And then it was Godzilla.
There you go.
And I'm honestly excited to see that one.
Nice, so go see it. It looks so good.
I don't think you have to have seen the other Godzilla, the 2014 one, for this one.
Okay.
It doesn't look like, because only two characters carry over is Ken Watanabe and Sally Hawkins.
So this is a sequel.
Yeah.
It is a sequel.
Okay.
It is.
But only two characters carry over.
Yeah, like it doesn't really set up any plot threads other than they find out Godzilla exists, and now it's just going to be there. All you need to know is Ken Watanabe is the Japanese scientist who just keeps going, let them fight. That's all you need to know going into this movie.
He controls the shield of monsters, essentially, which is called Monarch.
Nice.
By the way, I didn't even say my favorite performance, by the way, in Longshot.
Yeah, yeah.
Was Randall Park.
Okay.
That he had one scene.
Yeah.
And
you're
just...
You're quitting? That's disturbing.
Yeah, I don't know. He blends the, like, I don't know. I think he blends just like serious
comedy. I wish he had
blended
it a bit more.
Very well.
Yeah.
Longshot had a lot of like good character roles for a lot of different people. And it's like some work, some didn't quite work. But it's like, it's a good grab bag of like a lot of different comedians to do some good work.
And also, we were talking about this earlier, Andy Serkis.
Andy Serkis.
Yes.
is Parker Wembley.
I didn't realize that was Andy Serkis.
He plays
I saw his name and I'm like, huh.
Yeah, he's Parker Wembley.
Like a Rupert Murdoch type.
Yeah, like a Rupert Murdoch, Warren Buffett type guy. And I was like, this guy sounds familiar, but I can't put my finger. I actually took out my phone during the movie and looked it up and was like, it's Andy Serkis.
Mm-hmm.
It's Andy Serkis.
I didn't know that till right now.
Yeah.
Like, that's,
it's really good makeup.
Yeah.
It's a really good
makeup. But it's also good on his part because otherwise, there's so many times where you can see, even under all the makeup, you hear the actor, you hear, okay, this is who I'm looking at.
He embodied that character.
It's that's one of the moments where you can tell an actor how truly good, even if they're you just don't tell it's them.
Yes.
The best example I have of this, you ever see The Big Short?
Yes.
That's with Steve Carell.
Yep.
Christian Bale. Yep.
Yep. And Christian Bale. I knew he was in that coming in. I knew he was one of the guys, and it took me 5 minutes to be like, "Oh wait, this is Christian Bale."
Right.
Yeah. Like between the makeup and just his acting that you don't see in any other movie was just perfect. And once you can forget the actor, and just see the character,
that's
his good acting.
Yeah,
Christian Bale's a good actor.
I'd also mention Darkest Hour, Gary Oldman.
Gary Oldman, that's another like really transformative performance.
But he's always like he played Dracula.
I'd also say Lupita Nyong'o in Us.
Really?
Like the way that she's able, like you know
how
that they're
the
same
characters.
The way she plays,
really well
the way she plays Red is so amazing.
Hmm.
It's fantastic.
Just like the slight differences in like how they look, the mannerisms, how they move,
the way they
so
speak,
well done.
Everything is just fantastic.
Everyone does a pretty good job, like all the people playing like themselves and then the other. Mm-hmm. But it's like, especially Lupita Nyong'o did such an amazing job of it. She carried the movie really well.
Yes. Creepy as hell. It's so good.
And back to Longshot and Godzilla, do have one thread that connects them. O'Shea Jackson Jr., Ice Cube's son, who plays Seth Rogen's best friend in Longshot,
I was like, who
plays that one of the military guys in Godzilla King of Monsters.
I was like, who is this guy, and why does he's getting so much screen time?
I enjoyed him in Longshot because he reminded me of Philip Seymour Hoffman in Along Came
Polly. Oh, great role.
Yeah.
He reminded me of that role. And the movie had a lot of, early on, it had a lot of Along Came Polly vibes to me.
Right.
So that's what I enjoyed about it, but I liked when he showed up, he was really funny. He was yelling, like, Tad, Bagel Fridays for everyone. We know you took all the bagels.
I hated that.
I was waiting. I knew you were going to say
it. I know.
But
I loved his character throughout, and I loved the end with him. I loved when he, because that is so real. I was actually just talking, because I work part-time at Hillel at a school,
and
we were talking about basically cancel culture, where someone says the wrong thing just a little bit, and they get canceled. And that's part of bringing into it where he didn't want to tell him because he knew this is how he'd react.
That
this
was one
is
of the
what.
Best
and he was afraid for. And I loved it because this it's so true. And I loved it.
That was one of the best scenes. The scene that he has with Seth Rogen at his apartment was, to me, like, that made the movie, that scene.
It was pretty good.
Because it was what I said, that it just politics, it made fun of all politics. Yeah. It makes fun of people in general. It doesn't pick a side, and that's what I liked about it.
True. Well, guys, we got a few minutes left. How about plugs? What's going on in your lives? Anything you want to talk about? Anything you want to boost? Plug?
I'll plug. I looked up my two least favorite movies of last year was Action Point and Gotti.
Action Point.
That was the Johnny Knoxville Action Park movie.
We reviewed that, I think.
It wasn't me.
Okay.
It was really bad.
It sounds pretty terrible.
And I love Johnny Knoxville. I'm from that jackass generation.
Was that directed by Rennie Harlan?
I don't think it was directed by Rennie. I don't think that was directed by Rennie Harlan. It has him and Chris Pontius in it, and it's based off Action Park from Jersey.
Mm. Yeah, like and
they shot it all in South Africa. So it's supposed to be like Jersey, but then they made it California, but it's clearly South Africa.
Kind of like Die Hard at Disneyland.
Yes.
Like Beverly Hills Cop 3.
Beverly Hills Cop 3.
Essentially.
Die Hard at Disneyland.
Yeah. Jason, anything you want to plug?
I don't know. Most recent thing I did was Broken Hearted.
Awesome.
You should go see that.
Yeah, yeah. It's a romantic dramedy, I guess you'd call it.
Yeah. It was nice.
It was good. It was well made. And I think you were the star, my friend. Yeah.
I mean, I wasn't the star.
You
but
needed
I thought
more
I was
screen
good.
Time, I think.
I appreciate that greatly. I thought I was good.
You were the funny best friend, and it worked really well.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. CJ, anything you want to promote?
Just still doing my writing. I'm on Twitter at CJ Oakland. I'm just still trying to do, like, producing some short stuff. Like, I'm still working that with. It's so hard to get people's schedules together.
I know what you mean.
Like, we keep getting, like, pushback on it, because every time it's like, we're all going to get together this weekend and film something, and then it's like, someone can't make it. It's like, okay, let's push it back another 3 weeks.
Gotcha.
So, yeah. Hopefully we'll have something. I keep saying that every time.
Fingers crossed. And guys, about one more minute before I get into our sponsor, Magnitude's plugs. This weekend marks two very special days. We've got Cinco de Mayo, which is today, right now. But more importantly, we've got May the 4th, which was yesterday. So May the 4th be with you guys.
And also with you.
Thank you. Real quick, favorite Star Wars moment, CJ?
Ooh. There's a lot of them.
Or favorite Star Wars movie.
Then. Oh, make it even worse. I love the Battle of Hoth is one of my favorites. Like, that's one of the best openings.
Nice.
Just sells things so well.
Okay.
And I also, like, for another good moment, I loved in Last Jedi, Kylo Ren and Rey fighting in, like, the Emperor's Chamber, like, fighting against the Red Guards.
I love that.
That's one of the best cinematography in
the
Star Wars movie, I think.
The set is
like, the set is
the
great.
Choreography,
the fight is great.
Yeah.
It felt like this is the kind of movie Star Wars I always wanted to be, where it's like, this is what they could do with it. Like, the prequels, they always have, like, a lot more of the fights and, like, go for so much more CGI, and then it's like, this fight is what I always wish they would do.
Speaking of prequel fights, the episode one with Darth Maul.
That's great.
That's a great
with Ray Park.
Great fight.
I love that.
Such a great fighter.
Yeah, he's a great stunt performer. Jason, favorite Star Wars movie?
all of the original trilogy, but my favorite things about each the world building in the prequels, and the fact that Rey had no ancestry, like that it was just her in
that's
the new
thing
ones.
I loved.
That was what I loved in the new ones.
And real quick, Ryan,
my favorite is probably A New Hope. Just.
Nice.
For many, many reasons.
Classic.
But my favorite moment is probably when Han goes on with Chewie onto the Millennium Falcon for the first time in Force Awakens.
Because
it's just like the resonance, like the feeling that you had in the theater to see him back on the Millennium Falcon. He's like, we're home. Like, I love
Chewie,
that moment.
We're home.
I love that moment.
All right, guys. So some Magnitude plugs. We've got May 11th, the Holistic Fair in Chicago, Illinois. May 16th, the Boom Business Expo at the Hilton Hop Hog. The May 18th to 19th is the Southwest Women's Conference in Las Vegas, Nevada. May 19th is the Psychic Fair at the Hampton Inn. And June 19th is the Psychic Fair at the Courthouse Marriott. So guys, I want to thank you again for being here. This was awesome as always. And happy Cinco de Mayo. And May the 4th be with you. And guys, thank you for watching. And we'll be back next week, next Sunday, with our Tribeca Film Festival wrap-up show. So stay tuned for that. Take care, guys. Thank you.
Under the Radar is all new next week with more movie reviews and interviews on Strong Island Radio and Television. Stay tuned. We'll see you next week.